Talking to our Vice-Chancellor, Charlie Jeffrey. Hi, how are you today?
Hi there, I'm fine. Thank you very much. I hope you are too.
Yes, I'm great. Thank you so much for talking with us. I thought I'd just start off by asking you what your exact role is as Vice-Chancellor for those that might be new to the university that are watching.
Yeah, it's not an obvious title, is it really? I'm a mixture of things. I'm the chief academic of the university, so head of the academic business. I'm the chief executive, so responsible for the financial side, budgeting, making sure we can pay for everything. And I guess I'm also a kind of chief diplomat, so I represent the university outside in the city, nationally, internationally. So a mix of things.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. And what is a sort of typical day at work like for you? Obviously, it might not all be so typical at the moment, but what do you sort of get up to on a day-to-day basis?
Well, typically, I meet lots of people, and that's at the moment on Zoom screens and sometimes Microsoft Teams. So it's really an intense round of meetings with colleagues internally, externally doing that outward-facing role. But what I'm trying to do now also is to leave some gaps between meetings so that I can get out and walk around the campus and see how things are going in these unusual times, see how people are responding, how comfortable they're feeling, whether I can spot anything that might need addressing. And I guess that's kind of what I would do in normal times, except I'd probably be travelling to do lots more of my meetings than I do now. We've found we can meet people in London or in the USA or in China really quite effectively on Zoom.
Yeah, it does make you think, doesn't it? Yeah. And I was just going to ask, so you joined the University of York last year after having moved down from Edinburgh, if I'm correct. Do you now feel like you've settled into York a bit better a year on?
Yeah, I do. I love the place. I guess, you know, there were lots of things that I hadn't quite got round to doing on the cultural side in York by March. And now it was more difficult to do them, and I haven't found the time still. So I haven't really seen lots of the things in the city I'd like to, but I have seen lots of the countryside. And that's been a pleasure to the east in the Wolds, to the northeast in the moors, to the northwest in the Dales. We've had some good walks around.
Wonderful. Yeah, York is often voted one of the best places to live and work in the UK. So I guess you could maybe say you agree with that after seeing.
Oh yeah, I do, and it's a great city, and yeah, I love it. And I haven't been in it as much as I would like in the last few months. It has many hidden treasures. One of them for me, my wife is from Belgium, and through that I've picked up a predilection for Belgian beers. And there's a couple of bars in town which specialise in Belgian beers. Haven't been there recently, but they are great.
Yeah, wonderful. I mean, obviously it's a bit tricky to do anything like that at the moment, but you know, what with this turbulent year that you've had to deal with, you know, not just COVID-19, but the staff strikes last year as well. We were just wondering how you managed to sort of de-stress when everything gets a bit much.
walking up hills is one thing. I'm a runner though. I try to run two or three or four times a week, and it's a great thing for clearing the head and getting rid of any of the preoccupations of the previous day. I go out early in the morning and set myself up for the day.
Wow, that's very inspiring. Yeah, that's good. So sort of back to the obvious topic at the moment, COVID-19 and the disruptions that it is causing to university life. What would you sort of say to reassure the new students, the freshers who are coming in to the university this year, who might be anxious about starting university in this climate?
Well, you know, we've been preparing for months and thinking very, very hard about how to operate in these conditions. So you'll have seen all of the measures on campus, the hygiene measures, hand sanitizer all over the place, the spacing markers, the, you know, stay left markers, the one way systems, all designed to stop people from accumulating and getting in too close contact, face coverings as a standard policy for any indoor area. Mm-hmm. We've reduced face-to-face teaching, especially in the larger groups, to limit risks while continuing in smaller groups in all subjects. And we've thought very hard about the social side. You will have seen the spaces that USU is running, which we've helped them put together. We do want our students to have fun. We want them to have fun in ways which are safe, and they're probably the safest venues in the city. And I went to the forest last week, had a pint, and saw a very managed, very positive, very warm atmosphere. Mm-hmm. I guess one of the other things is, we are seeing COVID cases, and it's pretty inevitable, and that means that students have to self-isolate. If they've tested positive, or if they're in the same household, or if they have symptoms, until they can get a test. And one of the things that we've really focused very hard on is how we support students who self-isolate. This is not a punishment. It's actually a selfless act. This is students doing something to protect others. And I think that deserves recognition and support. So we've worked very hard to make sure we can get food and medicines and other supplies, laundry services, especially, that's relatively straightforward, not easy, but for students on campus. When they're in homes spread across the city, it's more difficult. But we've managed to arrange a special relationship with Morrisons, who are doing some dedicated online ordering and delivery for self-isolating students, which is an absolutely wonderful thing. Thinking very hard about support for people who might feel isolated, so all the mental health and wellbeing resources, working with USU and GSA to make sure that their activities have an online dimension which can support people who can't for a while come out, and so on. We hope we have covered all the bases, but we're always willing to hear if there's something that we might have missed out.
Well, that's really good to hear. And I think we've all sort of noticed a sort of strengthened sense of community, doing your part to protect others. I think, what you said is very true and very important. On more of the academic side, I was just wondering whether you think it's possible to maintain the university's high quality of teaching while adhering to, social distancing guidelines and laws. Do you think it's possible to still offer that sort of quality that York is renowned for?
Well, the teachers haven't changed. We still have brilliant experts in their fields, many of them at the real cutting edge in the world. And they've worked very, very hard to translate what they might normally be doing on campus into online settings, if that's what we need to do for big classes, working on campus in small classes, and thinking also, where we have to change, the government guidelines could impact on us and ask us to withdraw some of the face-to-face activity. We thought very, very hard about how we can adapt and continue to give not just a high quality experience, but a stimulating one in that very different context of engaging through a screen. And I think that quality concern that you raised has been at the heart of all of that thinking.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's really good to hear. Very reassuring. In lighter news, I guess you could say, the university placed in the top 20 on the Time and Sunday Times Good University Guide to 2021. So that means that we've risen two places from the year before. What do you think explains that rise?
That's a very welcome rise. It's only a small one. We would like to go higher still. But I think it reflects broadly what I was just saying about having brilliant people in their field who are committed to not just to sharing their expertise with students, but developing their own expertise through engagement with students. And I think that's a real part of that. Another part is something you mentioned, that sense of community. I came from a different university a year ago. It is clear that there is a really strong sense of community in York. It's a smaller place than many of the big Russell Group universities. It's got this campus setting, and I think that really helps as well, and is part of that wider experience. Yeah, and we've seen that recognised in the National Student Survey, in the TEF Gold of a couple of years back. And it's really, really important to us to stay there and to improve further if we can.
Definitely. And something else that I sort of noticed that really sort of excited me was that the University of York has recently partnered up with Askham Bryan College and Ferris Science to launch the initiative named Bio Yorkshire. So obviously the impact of COVID-19 is likely to be dwarfed by the impact of climate change more broadly. It's obviously a very important topic. I was just wondering if you could sort of explain what the aims of the Bio Yorkshire project are.
Yeah, happy to. It's really very exciting. And I've been closely involved in putting that partnership together. And it's really quite innovative. You know, the heartland of it is our brilliant expertise. And this is one of those areas where we are genuinely at the forefront in the world in biotechnology. So we have brilliant researchers and, of course, students benefit from that expertise going through the courses in biology and elsewhere. So there's that brilliant scientific expertise. We're working also with Askham Bryan College, which is a land-based college, so focused on the rural economy and focus at different skill levels than a university. So working with a further education college alongside the education we do gives us a whole sweep across skill levels and the skill pipeline. And then the other partner is Ferris Science, which is a private sector lab complex, used to be a Department for Agriculture lab, now privatised, and really connects our capabilities into the big private sector players. So we have our expertise connecting to the whole skills chain and connecting to the private sector. And I think through that, we can establish this part of the world as one of the most important locations for new industries around food production, the whole food chain from seed to plate, around biorenewables, so replacing carbon-intensive sources with bioengineered sources, and the circular economy, making sure we don't waste stuff, that we repurpose stuff through biological and chemical processes so that it retains usefulness after we've consumed it in its first form. Now the opportunity there is huge, because these are all future oriented industries, and they fit the moment of a world challenge around climate, the climate emergency, and we can be a part of all of that. All of what I've described is about using resources less carbon intensively, or replacing carbon. And we've worked together with those partners, with the local authorities in the region, with the LEP, which is the body which connects the public and private sectors around here. And our collective ambition is to make York and North Yorkshire the UK's first carbon negative region. So not carbon neutral, carbon negative, putting more carbon away than we are generating through our activities. I think that's really exciting. And what we've done through that partnership is effectively put in a proposal to government for significant funding. We'll see how that goes. But one way or another, we're going to push down that direction. And I think it's going to be a landmark initiative for the university in the coming years.
Wow, thank you for that. It's really great to hear about a very positive and encouraging sort of project amongst all the uncertainty of everything else at the moment. So yeah, thank you so much. I think that's a great note to end on, positive one. Thank you so much for talking to us. It was great meeting you and hearing everything you have to say. So yeah, we'll let you go. But
always great to talk to YSTV, and hopefully we can do it in more normal circumstances at some point in the not too distant future.
I hope so. Thank you so much.